British empiricism started from Bacon's inductive method based on sense certainty, taken from the Venetians. Then came Locke. Locke was followed by the solipsist Berkeley, who denied any basis in reality for our sense impressions. They're a kind of videotape played in each one of our heads by some unknown supernatural agency. Perception was the only existence there was. Then came the Scots lawyer and diplomat David Hume. For Hume also, there is really no human self, but only a bundle of changing perceptions. In his early works, Hume attacked the idea of cause and effect. For Hume, there is no necessary connection between a cause and an effect that the human mind can know with certainty. We only have some vague association or habit of thought that, as far as we know, one phenomenon has usually been followed by another. But in these same earlier works, Hume had at least accepted the importance of filling the tabula rasa of each new human mind with a stock of received ideas, of conduct, which can be lumped under the heading of custom. During Hume's later years, the power of the Shelburne faction became dominant in Britain. British liberal empiricism tends to be several degrees more rotten than its continental European counterparts.
In October of 1776, a 28-year-old English barrister named Jeremy Bentham wrote contemptuously of the Declaration of Independence, which had been signed as an act of the Continental Congress on July 4th of that year. "This," he spewed, "they hold to be a truth self-evident." At the same time, to secure these rights, they are satisfied that government should be instituted. They see not that nothing that was ever called government ever was or ever could be exercised but at the expense of one or another of those rights, that some one or other of those pretended unalienable rights is alienated. In these tenets, they have outdone the extravagance of all former fanatics. Shortly after penning this venom, Bentham made his philosophical breach with the American Republicans all the more clear in a lengthy tract titled "An Introduction to the Principles of Morals and Legislation," published in 1780. That manuscript would not only prescribe the founding principles of British philosophical radicalism, it would propel Bentham into the very center of a then emerging new British Foreign Office and British Foreign Intelligence Service, consolidated under the guiding hand of William Petty, Lord Shelburne, a man who at the time was de facto, if not de jure, Doge of Britain. Bentham categorically rejected any distinction between man and the lower beasts, defining man instead as a creature driven purely by hedonistic impulse. To wit, he wrote, quote, "Nature has placed mankind under the governance of two sovereign masters, pain and pleasure. It is for them alone to point out what we ought to do, as well as to determine what we shall do. Every effort we make to throw off our subjection will serve but to demonstrate and confirm it. The principle of utility, the greatest happiness or greatest felicity principle, recognizes this subjection and assumes it for the foundation. Systems which attempt to question it deal in caprice instead of reason, in darkness instead of light." So taken with Bentham was Lord Shelburne that he installed the writer, who fancied himself alternately as literally the reincarnation of Sir Francis Bacon and as the Sir Isaac Newton of the moral sciences, in an apartment at his Bowood estate. Shelburne assigned to Bentham an English and Swiss editor to ensure the widest dissemination of Bentham's works in both the English and French-speaking worlds. Later, Bentham's works would even be more widely circulated throughout Latin America during his years of intimate collaboration with the American traitor and assassin of Alexander Hamilton, Aaron Burr, and with revolutionist General Francisco de Miranda, a Venezuelan by birth who played a leading role as a paid agent of the British East India Company in the Jacobin Terror in France, and Simon Bolivar. Aaron Burr, fleeing the United States, took up residence at the home of Bentham in London, and the two men conspired on a number of occasions to establish an empire first in Mexico and later in Venezuela. At the very moment of his taking up with Bentham, Lord Shelburne was in the process of launching his most daring political intrigues. In June of 1780, weary of the failed prosecution of the war in North America, and convinced that the ministry of Lord George North would bring eternal ruin to his dreams of permanent empire, Lord Shelburne, through the East India Company and its ally Baring Bank, bankrolled a Jacobin mob to descend on London, ostensibly in protest over the granting of Irish reforms. The so-called Irish reforms amounted to little more than the forced conscription of Irishmen to fight in the British Army in North America, a move that Shelburne hoped would also defeat the pro-American Republican movement inside Ireland that had nearly launched its own successful Republican revolt against Britain in 1779. Led by Lord George Gordon, the Protestant rabble stormed Westminster, sending parliamentarians and lords alike down flights of stairs, out windows, and to the hospitals. For 8 days, London was ransacked, culminating in the storming of the Newgate prison and the freeing of all of the prisoners who joined in the assault on the parliament. Lord Shelburne, as head of the Interior Committee of the House of Lords, personally assured the maximum terror by delaying the reading of the Riot Act, which called out the Home Guard, until violence had spread to every corner of the city. When the flames died, the ministry of Lord North was in ashes as well. North resigned as prime minister, and within months, Shelburne was himself in the new Rockingham cabinet as foreign secretary for the Northern District, subsuming the North American colonies. From that post, he would be the principal negotiator, directing the British team in Paris, sitting across the table from Benjamin Franklin. By this time also, King George III had declared himself wholly subservient to the Shelburne-led East India Company faction, the Venetian Party. As the result of these events, the shadow government formally took charge of the official state apparatus. The intelligence operations formerly housed at the East India Company were henceforth run out of the Foreign Ministry and the British Secret Intelligence Services. A postscript on Lord Gordon, Shelburne's agent provocateur. After a brief stay in the Tower of London, foreshortened by Shelburne's personal intervention with the Crown, Lord Gordon made off to friendlier grounds in the Netherlands, where, to the astonishment of his Scottish Presbyterian cronies, he became a convert to Jewish Kabbalism, taking the name Israel Bar Abraham. Shortly thereafterwards, he surfaced in Paris as an occult advisor to Marie Antoinette, and from that position participated in Shelburne's intrigues against the French Bourbons. The Jacobin insurrection in Paris during 1791 to 1793 was a replay on grander scale of the earlier Shelburne-instigated Gordon riots, down to the storming of the Bastille prison and the unleashing of the criminals. Lord Shelburne, as foreign minister, took the position that the former colonies in North America must be once again brought under the British yoke, but not through the deployment of military might or through claims of property title. For Shelburne, the battle cry of the New Venice, New Rome was free trade. As early as 1763, in a famous carriage ride from Edinburgh to London, Shelburne had commissioned two works from one of his East India Company scribblers, a man named Adam Smith. First, he commissioned Smith to prepare the research outlines for the study that would be later completed by another India House propagandist, Edward Gibbon, on the decline and fall of the Roman Empire, a study critical to Shelburne's commitment to establish a new Third Roman Empire headquartered in London. In addition, he ordered the preparation of an apologia for free trade, which Smith completed himself in 1776 under the title The Wealth of Nations. In 1787, Shelburne's leading intelligence agent, Jeremy Bentham, went one better than Smith by publishing a series of letters from Russia that were assembled in a pamphlet titled In Defense of Usury. The final letter, addressed to Smith himself, chastised the India House economist for not going far enough in his embrace of unbridled monetary dictatorship. Bentham demanded an end to all restrictions on usurious interest rates, employing the liberal argument that suppression of usury stifled invention. Smith immediately wrote of Bentham's In Defense of Usury, quote, "The work is one of a superior man." Shelburne's own most eloquent plea for unbridled free trade and usury came during his brief tenure as prime minister from 1782 to 1783. Although he had formerly preferred to steer British politics from behind the scenes in his capacity as the chairman of the three-man secret committee directing the East India Company, Shelburne felt compelled to briefly take the formal reins of government to ensure the launching of his new British imperium. On January 27th, 1783, Shelburne stood before the House of Lords to argue for ratification of the Treaty of Paris, formally bringing to an end the American Revolution and the conflict with France and Spain. Quote, "You have given America, with whom every call under the heaven urges you to stand on the footing of brethren, a share in a trade, the monopoly of which you sordidly preserved to yourselves. Monopolies, some way or other, are very justly punished. They forbid rivalry, and rivalry is of the very essence of well-being of trade. I avow that monopoly is always unwise, but if there is any nation under heaven which ought to be the first to reject monopoly, it is the English. Situated as we are between the old world and the new, and between southern and northern Europe, all we ought to covet on earth is free trade. With more industry, with more capital, with more enterprise than any trading nation on earth, it ought to be our constant cry, let every market be open." Shelburne's policy of unbridled free trade war between Britain against the United States nearly destroyed the American Republic at birth. Fortunately, some of America's founding fathers clearly and unambiguously understood the danger of Shelburne's free trade ruse. They launched a crucial debate over the need for a strong federal constitution. But for the Federalist debate and the resulting United States Constitution of 1789, Shelburne's scheme for the rapid bankrupting and reabsorbing of North America into the British Imperium would have likely succeeded. Alexander Hamilton was blunt in his Federalist Paper Number 11, published in November 1787. Quote, "The adventurous spirit of America has already excited uneasy sensations in several of the maritime powers of Europe. If we could unite and can continue united, we may counteract a policy so unfriendly to our prosperity in a variety of ways. Suppose, for instance, we had a government in America capable of excluding Great Britain from all of our ports. What would be the probable operation of this step upon her politics? Would it not enable us to negotiate with the fairest prospect of success for commercial privileges of the most valuable and extensive kind in the domain of that kingdom? Even with these pressing matters still unresolved in North America, Shelburne and Bentham turned their attention to another critical front directly across the English Channel in France. The 7 years' war of 1756 to 1763 had stripped France of its once formidable maritime capacity. Shelburne now sought to destroy France as an economic and military rival on the continent as well. From the outset, the Jacobin Terror was a British East India Company, British Foreign Office orchestrated affair. The bloody massacre of France's scientific elite was systematically carried out, although by French hands, manning French guillotines, by the guiding hand from London. Jacques Necker, a Geneva-born Protestant, slavishly pro-British banker, had been installed through the efforts of Shelburne's leading ally in France, Philippe, the Duke of Orléans, as finance minister. Necker's daughter, the infamous Madame de Staël, would later run one of Shelburne's most important Parisian salons. Although Necker had failed in repeated efforts to block France from allying with the Americans during the American Revolution, he did succeed in presiding over the depletion of the French treasury and the collapse of the French credit system, greatly aided by the free trade agreements between England and France. Economic crisis across France was the precondition for political chaos and insurrection, and Shelburne readied the projected destabilization by creating what he himself called the Radical Writers' Shop at his Bowood estate, staffed by Jeremy Bentham, the Genevan Antoine Dumont, and the Englishman Samuel Romilly. Speeches were prepared by Bentham, translated and transported by diplomatic pouch and other means to Paris, where leaders of the Jacobin Terror, Marat, Danton, Robespierre, delivered the fiery oratories. Records of East India Company payments to these leading Jacobins are still on file to this day at the British Museum. So taken up with the events in France was Bentham that on the 25th of November, 1791, he wrote to National Assemblyman J.P. Garand, offering to move to Paris to take charge of the penal system. Enclosing a draft of his Panopticon proposal, Bentham wrote, quote, "Allow me to construct a prison on this model. I will be the gaoler. You will see by the memoir, this gaoler will have no salary, will cost nothing to the nation. The more I reflect, the more it appears to me that the execution of the project should be in the hands of the inventor." At the same time he was proposing to assume the post of chief gaoler of the Jacobin Terror, which sent many of France's greatest scientists and the majority of pro-American Republicans to the guillotines or the prisons, Bentham made no bones about his loyalties. In accepting the honorary title of Citizen of France, Bentham wrote to the Jacobin Interior Minister in October 1792, quote, "I should think myself a weak reasoner and a bad citizen were I not, though a royalist in London, a Republican in Paris." Bentham's Panopticon scheme was literally a slave labor camp first designed when he was visiting his brother, a Shelburne spy in Russia, in 1787. Asked by Prince Potemkin, the minister of Catherine the Great, to help procure a steam engine to build up Russian industry, Bentham argued that human labor, not steam power, ought to be sufficient. His design, complete with elaborate architectural drawings, called for criminals, the indigent, and the retarded, along with their children, to be placed in jail cells equipped with primitive machinery, run by a central power source, which in turn was fueled by swings, merry-go-rounds, and seesaws in the children's own cell block. The energy expended by the children playing on the toys would drive the factory. A central guard room affixed with two-way mirrors would permit one guard to oversee the slave labor of hundreds of inmates. Above the main door of the panopticon was to be a sign reading, quote, "Had they been industrious when free, they need not have drudged here like slaves." During his tour of Russia and the Ottoman Empire, when he devised his panopticon scheme and wrote In Defense of Usury, Bentham had also written in his personal diary, "It is an old maxim of mine that interest, as love, should be free." It is therefore of little shock that we find Bentham also writing in 1785 an essay on the subject of pederasty, arguing against any sanctions against homosexuality, lesbianism, masturbation, and bestiality. Bentham dismissed the harsh penalties then in force against pederasty as the result of irrational religious fears born of the Old Testament destruction of Sodom and perpetuated by society's, quote, irrational antipathy to pleasure in general and sexual pleasure in particular. Christian morality, like every other expression of natural law, had no place in Bentham's world of pleasure and pain. In the wake of the initial success in bringing France to its knees via the brutal Jacobin terror, Bentham sponsored several generations of philosophical radicals, from his closest proteges, James Mill and Sir John Bowring, to James Mill's son, John Stuart Mill, Thomas Carlyle, and David Urquhart. Carlyle, under the watchful eye of John Stuart Mill, penned the official British history of the French Revolution. Needless to say, burying the role of Shelburne, Bentham, and their entire cabal in that horrific event. Bowring, Bentham's long-suffering personal secretary, would supervise the publication of Bentham's collected works in an 11-volume series, would serve as Lord Palmerston's agent handler of the notorious Giuseppe Mazzini, and would instigate the Second Opium War against China from his post as emissary in Canton. Urquhart, one of the youngest of the Benthamites, would play the role of agent handler for Karl Marx. Upon his death in 1832, Bentham's body was dissected and stuffed, his head cast in bronze and placed at his feet, with a mask affixed in its place. For years, the mummified Bentham, seated in his favorite chair inside a glass case, was an ever-present participant in all of the meetings of his radical circle. To this day, the mummy enjoys a place of prominence at London University.